are made for walking, and that's just what they'll do.
The year was 1966. Her song, Boots, was at the top of the charts and turned her into an overnight singing sensation. It's been over 20 years since she wore those boots, but thanks to MTV, a whole new generation is being introduced to the song and the woman who made it famous. Please welcome today's Woman of the Hour. Welcome her back, Nancy Sinatra. Good to see you. Well, it seems everything old is new again, isn't it?
Thanks a lot, dear.
No.
Thanks.
But I mean, Nettie, that's a piece of history, and you'll be piece of trivia before too long with that song.
Already, I think.
Yeah. What do you think about when you see that all over again?
I think the song has a life of its own, because I had nothing to do with the fact that it's out again. I mean, it's just so strange that it has legs and it walks by itself, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but what's wonderful about it is everybody's rediscovering Nancy Sinatra, people who didn't have a chance to see you.
Two of me. That
two
one
of
and
you.
This
yes.
One.
All right. Well, let's tell everybody what's on the show today. All right.
Okay.
Plus a special guest that we'll introduce a little bit later on. First.
Oh, we're going to tell you how a group of women who were battered by their husbands are joining together in an effort to fight back.
Now, speaking of MTV, I want you to take a look at this. That man, he's a man with four hits and four hit videos, Michael Bolton.
And we'll share a great breakfast with Chef Tell.
Oh, you bet. And we're going to tell you about a simple at-home test that can measure the effectiveness of the calcium supplements that you take. All this and more on Tuesday's edition of Our Magazine. FBI studies, 4 million American women are battered each year. Karen Connell has been with us before, and she shared her story of how she escaped an abusive husband and sought refuge in a shelter. But the story doesn't end there. Her husband followed her, slashed her throat, and left her with permanent damage to her vocal cords. Today, Karen is here with two other women who have survived the battering experience, Pam Page and Betty Grimm. But it's the issue of survival that we're going to talk about today, and let's start with Betty. Betty, a number of years have passed since you went through your situation. There were no shelters then. There were no support groups. And you had children. And your husband, I believe, came from an abusive home as well. Can you talk about the kind of abuse? And I know from reading it was quite serious.
Well, the abuse started subtly with just a lot of control. And me being from, quote, a normal family, I was not cognizant of what was going on. He selected my friends, he picked my clothes. It got to the point where we went out socially, I talked to the right people, or if I didn't, I got slapped around, and that slapping got to the point where I ended up in the hospital. I had a hairline crack in my skull, and to this day I will always have some form of glasses that I'll have to wear because of that.
Now, you did walk out of that situation, but I think, to use your phrase, you went through that phase, the take 'em back phase, am I correct?
Mm-hmm.
And how long did that last?
It went on for a period of about 4 years for me. Geographically, I'm from the South, and the area that I lived in, you were supposed to always save the marriage and be responsible. And my own mother encouraged me, you know, go back, you know, try to save. The kids need their father, etc. So I went through a period of about 4 years going back and forth. And each time I left this man and went on my own, I did fairly well, but still felt like I needed to go back to him. I got an apartment one time, survived on my own pretty well for 9 months, and ended up taking him back and going through the same ordeal all over again.
What was the straw that broke the camel's back for you?
My daughter, that's now 24, was about 5 years old, and I had a sister living with me. And she said, come here, I want you to see something. And this child was just laying up in the bed, looking in the ceiling, and she was crying, but it was a silent crying, and it just got next to me, and I just said, I'm going to take you out of this. It was her tears and the way it had affected her, because he was a type of batterer that thought he was protecting the children, so he only fought me when the children were asleep, he thought.
Yeah, they do hear. Mm-hmm. They're very, very aware of it. Pam, in your situation, it was a suicide attempt that finally gave you the realization that you had to get out of it?
Correct. Changed my life, turned my life around.
Yeah. Badly battered?
Very badly battered. I had a broken nose. He would beat me in the street until I lost unconsciousness. This was in front of my kids, unlike Betty. My husband did care of my kids, were around or not. And my neighbors would witness it, but would not offer help, didn't want to get involved. And it was just continuous abuse.
Was your feeling prior to leaving that you had to stick it out for the kids?
It was for the kids, and also my husband was under psychiatric care, and he was on disability. And his psychiatrist had told me that I could not ask him for a divorce because it would only worsen his condition. And it was after his doctor had told me that I went home and attempted suicide.
Did that make you feel guilty?
It made me feel very guilty.
Oh, I'm sure it did. Well, did you hear what she just said? She
yes.
said it was after the doctor told her that she went home and attempted suicide.
And for so long, I was under the belief, as so many women in this situation are, that I could do something to help him. It was something I was doing. He was sick because of me.
Oh. And now it's a question of control, isn't it? Control over your own life, Karen?
Right.
Just we're talking about survival. These women have survived, but what a way to survive. There are... Certainly now we've got shelters, we've got support groups, we've got people like the three of you who all now work either counseling or with victim advocacy groups. Let's talk about survival. What do women have to learn? What do they have to master so they can survive this?
I think that women are survivors, but they're just not really in touch with that until someone tells them, but until someone gives them permission, so to speak. Women, millions of women, are surviving every day. There are women out there who are still in the abusive situations who have developed coping mechanisms that a lot of other people never have to develop. These are women who are being, who have had a war declared on them, but it's really an undeclared war. And there are no benefits out there. They don't have holidays for veterans who have survived domestic violence.
What would you tell, what's the first thing they have to do? How would you advise them to get out? Who would they call? What would they do?
There are hotlines and shelters all over the country now. And the first step towards getting back yourself, your self-respect, who you are, and finding out just how strong you really are, is to make that phone call and reach out and get some help.
Because, I mean, if you can develop a mechanism to cope with that kind of battering, terrible situation, you certainly can develop beyond survival of a situation. You can get out of there, can't you? What do you do? Don't you have to start looking at yourself as a survivor, not a victim?
But there are a lot of circumstances going on. For example, as I said before, my mother made me feel like it was my responsibility, and I just thought, well, one more time, I'm going to make it right. I'm going to do one something that's going to change this whole situation.
With that knowledge and with Pam's experience, and certainly with Karen's experience, is that worth it?
No.
Is it at any time worth it?
But you don't know it at the time.
You don't realize you have
choices. But that's why we're here today, is to let people
make.
Know if they don't know it at the time. What about therapy for the husband? Is that worth it?
Yes.
When I say therapy for the husband, of course it involves the whole family, but tell me about that.
Actually, that's not true. It doesn't involve the whole family together. And that's one of the things that also sends women back. It kept me there an extra year, going in family therapy. Because basically family therapists treat this like it's a family systems problem, which says that the whole family is dysfunctional, and they end up blaming the victim again.
Mm-hmm.
There is qualified help out there for the men. Not a whole lot, but it's specially trained therapists who deal with batterers. And they say this is a batterers group.
All right. Is it safe to say the first time this happens, from all of your perspectives, the first time you're at home and your husband gives you a beating, that's the time to get out of there?
Definitely.
Is there a time sooner than that? You said a subtle form of abuse.
Definitely. In fact, had I known what I know as a counselor now, I would never have married my husband. I was given a signal but did not know it. A couple of things. He came from an abusive home where his father abused his mother.
Right.
And when I was a senior in high school, he slapped me really bad one time, and that was my first indication.
All right. Thank you very much, Betty. Pam, thank you. Karen, nice to see you again. And keep up the good work. And I suppose what we can leave you with is that if you're in a situation that we have described here, even if you're in one that's not as serious, even if you're in one that that may parallel what Betty just spoke of, a slap or that subtle form of abuse, call someone. Find a hotline and call, because it's not your fault. And there certainly are things that can be done. Thank you all very much for being with us. And also, I'd like to mention the LA Survivors Task Force that Karen is involved with, and I hope it just continues to grow for you, Karen.
Thanks.
You're very welcome. How effective is the calcium that you take? Well, we're going to show you a test that you can do at home next. Changed in recent years, millions of Americans have become aware of osteoporosis and the value of calcium supplements in its prevention. Just how effective are these supplements in combating the illness, and are some better than others? Joe Graydon, pharmacologist and co-author of the new book 50 Plus, the Graydon's People's Pharmacy for Older Adults, is here with some answers. First of all, Joe, let's just briefly discuss calcium, its relationship to osteoporosis.
Well, osteoporosis affects millions of people. Every year, over 200,000 fracture hips and puts them in the hospital and kills a lot of people. So osteoporosis is a terrible toll for older people. But a lot of people have been seduced by calcium, and these are just a few of the products that are available. Literally dozens of calcium products on pharmacy shelves, and people think that calcium will cure osteoporosis. Nothing is further from the truth. You have to exercise, and for many, estrogen may be necessary.
What is the value with exercise?
Well, it forces those bones to really start rebuilding bone. When the astronauts go up in space, they actually develop osteoporosis. They lose bone because of weightlessness, so exercise can force those bones to keep adding calcium and get stronger.
Yeah, now you mentioned estrogen. Its value, it's not without risk, though.
Well, most people these days are being put on Premarin and Provera, and these are very effective medications at preventing osteoporosis, but the progesterone, the Provera, can in fact raise cholesterol and may increase the risk of blood clots. So you have to be careful. These drugs do have some risks, even though they have tremendous benefits.
Now, as far as the effectiveness of the products, they are different.
Oh boy, are they ever. And I think a lot of people don't realize that many of the calcium products on pharmacy shelves may not be dissolving in their digestive tracts. So what we have is the home do-it-yourself calcium test. All you need to do is pop your calcium pill into a glass. It doesn't matter what kind of glass, and you don't need to use any special vinegar, and you just pour in about, oh, you know, 2 or 3 ounces, that's all.
And then this is just white vinegar, right?
This is just white vinegar. And then you wait about 30 minutes, and we have already done that, so we can demonstrate what will happen after you've put your vinegar and your calcium together. And you can see there's a tremendous difference between some products. This one right here is sitting just like a little rock. It hasn't done anything. This one is completely dissolved, as is the Tums for the Tummy, by the way, a very good source of calcium.
I eat those.
And this one isn't doing very much either. So the kind of calcium you select will have a profound influence on you.
Now, Nancy brought hers, and I don't know, which one is Nancy's?
Hers dissolved very nicely.
It did dissolve very nicely.
Yes, it did.
All right, what happens if it doesn't dissolve?
It may pass right out of your body. Exactly.
All right.
So you're wasting your money. By the way, how you take your medicine is terribly important. Even if your calcium does dissolve, if you were to take it with whole wheat bread, oatmeal, or spinach, it may not work, because the ingredients in oatmeal and spinach and bread, phytates and oxalates, can prevent the calcium from doing
all
its
right,
job.
So when and what with should you
take it? Okay, older people have less acid in their stomach, so they should take calcium with food, but not these kinds of foods, just with other kinds of medications.
All right, we don't want to get into what's good and what's bad and what's halfway here, but suffice to say that the simple vinegar test will give you an idea if the calcium supplement you're taking is effective.
And remember that good old-fashioned milk is a good source of calcium and magnesium and manganese, which also will help that calcium do its job, plus vitamin D. So Mom was right. Milk may be just terrific.
No, is it, I'm sorry, Gary,
no,
is it
ahead.
True that you have to take calcium with something else for it to absorb? Mine is with magnesium.
Magnesium and vitamin D, absolutely essential, Nancy,
otherwise
if you want your calcium to work. Otherwise, it doesn't do its job.
All right, so it has to have some other ingredients in it.
Exactly.
All right, our guest, Joe Graydon. The book is 50 Plus, The Graydon's People's Pharmacy for Older Adults.
That's the one.
Oh, I like it. Thanks, Joe, for
being
with
you,
us.
Gary.
I'm so glad
Nancy.
I remember that. All right, we're going to talk with Nancy and her mom and tell you why Boots is back and back big next.
These boots are made for walking, and that's just what they're to. One of these days, these boots are going to walk all over you.
Happens in the best of families. I'm here with my woman of the hour, Nancy Sinatra. Now, when this is one of the early videos, 1966, I guess, when Boots came out, did it create an image problem for you?
Major.
Yeah, how so?
I was Nancy Nice Lady up until then,
yeah.
Yeah, the minute Boots came out, I was the darling of the truckers. Stuff like that.
I'll bet your mail changed.
No, it was great. It was wonderful for me. Yeah, it did change.
Yeah.
But I didn't know how to do that, so they really had to teach me how to sound sort of tough and nasty. So that became my nickname, by the way.
What,
nasty.
Tough and nasty?
Nasty.
Yeah. Now that it's being replayed again on MTV, what do Amanda and AJ think about it? What are they, 13, 14, Amanda?
Yeah, this is their review. Mom!
Are you serious? What do they think?
They can't stand it, you know. Kids
at that age get embarrassed with their parents, don't they?
I embarrass them if I dance in public, you know.
Yeah, but they'll sit there and watch somebody else do it and just get all mm-hmm. stoked, as Jennifer in the office says.
Mm-hmm. Stoked, yeah.
Stoked. I don't know what stoked means. It has something to do with an engine on a train, I suppose. I don't know. Well, look, let's take a moment and look at it again and see if we can get stoked all over again.
You keep playing where you shouldn't be playing. And you keep thinking that you'll never get burned. Ha! I just found me a brand new box of matches, yeah. And what he knows you ain't had time to learn. These boots are made for walking, and that's just what they'll do. One of these days these boots are gonna walk all over you.
Oh, that's great. I have this tremendous urge to go out to a diner and get a cup of coffee or something. That is hysterical. Now, you recently performed it, or was the video performed on China Beach, the television show?
No, China Beach was newly done. And what we did was we went and we got a hair piece. There's the picture.
Oh, so you did it over again.
We tried, uh-huh. And I said, you've got to make me look 20 years younger, to the director. So I think they shot it where the camera is looking up into the sun,
mm-hmm.
you know? So what you're seeing of me is mostly backlighting.
Yeah.
So I think it's going to be all right. I haven't seen it.
Yeah, and of course, the setting for China Beach is Vietnam, and this coming out in 66,
right.
The timing was just perfect. Now,
one of your guys on your crew here, Gilbert, he was in Vietnam when I was there.
What, Gilbert,
and today he came over to
property
me,
master
yeah,
here?
And he said, I just want to say thank you. I said, for what? He said, because I was in Vietnam and I saw one of your shows.
No kidding.
Isn't that neat? That happens all the time.
It does. I'll bet it does. Something else that's neat, I mentioned a very special guest, and I did allude to her during the introduction. We've had, we've had Tina on the show, we've had Frank, and of course, Frank Jr., we've had Frank Sr., that wonderful interview that you did with him, and now we've got another member of the Sinatra family. Why don't you introduce us to her?
Well, she's a gem. She gave us all life, and she continues to do just that. She's still giving us life. She's the most remarkable woman I've ever known in my whole life. I want you to meet my mom.
Okay.
Hi,
Well, I don't know, but the hair on the back of my neck is standing up. Now, what? Tell me a little bit about this. When Nancy starts to introduce you, she starts to well up. You start to well up. What is this unique thing about the Sinatras?
I think we love each other.
You certainly do.
It's as simple as that.
Now, before we go any further, I want to run a moment from this wonderful interview that Nancy did with Frank Sr. And I think you had asked him about the kids, well, the now grown children, about yourselves. And this is what he had to say.
I have been at times very lax in my duties as a father in the early days, because I was on the road all the time and away most of the time. And then right on top of that kind of lifestyle came the divorce from your mother. So that wasn't very good as being a father. But on the other hand, I always loved you three kids, and constantly, 24 hours a day, worried about you all the time, thought about you, wanted to do more things for you, but your mother would stop me every once in a while. She'd say, "You're bored enough now, let's not do any more.
Don't spoil the kids."
Them, and all that kind of jazz.
That's very true. He would overindulge. I think because he was gone so much, and he tried to counteract that by giving. But it was tough raising three children of a celebrity.
You really had the responsibility.
Yeah.
So how do you keep them out of the fishbowl, and how do you keep them with a sense of equilibrium?
That wasn't easy either, but somehow we managed. I being low profile helped, I think.
Well, you didn't really keep us out of the fishbowl. We didn't have any choice in that. Well,
but I rationed their activities. I rationed what they were allowed to get.
She was tough, Gary.
I was tough.
You were grounded every
really
other
tough.
Week.
Grounded you every other week?
Oh, I would ground them. And if it ever got too tough, I'd then call on Dad. I'd say, "You got to take over, you know."
Mm-hmm.
But I felt that they needed discipline and being watched, particularly more so because of who they were.
But whether or not you were in the fishbowl, as you so often were.
We all were.
But the point is that all three, Frank Jr., Tina, and Nancy, have all, I mean, they're level. Do you know what I mean? They don't, there's not that kind of
meet
craziness.
The leveler.
Well,
yeah,
I think
that's
a little
remarkable.
Bit of the levelizer, because we had to keep our feet on the ground, mm-hmm. because, you know, you could take off and Lord knows what could happen.
Yeah. What was the biggest challenge for you as far as the children?
Well,
not becoming
the biggest hurt was when my son was kidnapped.
Yes.
But the challenges of raising them, it's no different than any other family. It's trying to teach them the good from bad. Not all black and white. There are grays at times, you know.
Did you ever give them...
You know, you have a child.
Oh, yeah.
And
did you ever give them advice, Nancy, about the people that would befriend them? Because the Sinatras have always been a very well-known name, and Frank has always been, well, after From Here to Eternity and a couple of albums, extremely, you know, powerful, and you never know how people are coming at you and for what reason. Was that ever an issue with the kids?
Well, not really, because they were aware. I made them aware that Father was a phenomena, that unlike other celebrities, he was more so. And in teaching them to take care of themselves first, watch out for the people around them. Now with my granddaughters, you should see me, I'm even worse.
You know, the day that Nancy did the interview, you were there. I think you brought the children back.
I picked the children up
yeah.
from school.
And you came back, and you and Frank embraced.
Of course.
I am always impressed with this very unique relationship that you have kept with Frank.
Well, we had a lot of years
loyal.
Together, and yeah. we've had children together, so consequently, you don't forget those things.
Yeah, well, I wish a lot of people felt the same way that you did, and Frank does, because
it's
hard for some.
Yeah, we're very fortunate that we have a good relationship,
yeah.
and I've worked at it, actually, with the children to keep it. I mean, everything needs to be nurtured, even a separation. Where there are children.
Now, that's an interesting thought.
Mm-hmm.
You have remained, as you say, very private.
Yes.
You have not remarried. What does Nancy Sinatra do?
Nancy Sinatra has an interesting life. She has lovely children. She has lovely grandchildren. She goes to the theater a great deal. I've given up a lot of the charitable work I did because I had some health problems, and now I'm living a nice, leisurely life.
Well, you look wonderful.
I go to the theater very often. even the little theaters in Santa Monica, anywhere. Mm-hmm.
And the Dodger games.
And the Dodger games.
And the Dodger games.
Always the Dodgers, okay. And we go on the picnics that way. Well, it's really a nice life.
We're so glad you joined us today.
I'm glad to
and
be
thanks
here.
Thanks for asking your mom to come along.
It's a pleasure.
It's great. Nancy Sinatra Sr. and, I don't know, you don't say Junior. Just
we
Nancy.
We say Nancy Sinatra Sr. and Junior.
And Junior,
we
you
still
do.
Do.
Okay. Thanks for being with us, Nancy.
Glad to be here.
Thank you.
Love
we'll
to
be
know.
Back with Jose Abair. Bye-bye. The dependable Maytag washer and dryer you've always wanted. Choose side by side or stacked upright. Same size, same long-lasting Maytag dependability. Now we know him as the master of the makeover. Today he's going to work his magic on a woman who has overcome cancer. Please welcome Jose Abair. I mentioned a successful battle with cancer. Who is this young lady we're about to meet?
Well, I mean, she sent us a letter a few months ago, and she told us about her problem with the cancer, and she overcame it, like you just said. And I thought it was nice and rewarding for her, because I have to give a tip to all the people who are affected with cancer or other diseases, mm-hmm. And when it affects their hair, so there is always a way of making her hair look better.
All right.
And in her case, I mean, she did lose some hair. It grew back. Her hair became very, very dry. So I did tell her what to do, and we're going to meet the way she looked yesterday when I
all
met
right.
her.
Here she is before.
Chris smiles. This is the way I met her yesterday. Obviously, long blonde hair, very, very dry. It did grow back, actually, so she had a lot of it. But I wanted to create a certain style.
Hi.
And so here she is now, I believe, right?
Here she is. She smiles. Wow. I like that. Do you like it?
Yes, very much.
I know your husband's here today. What does he think?
Oh, I love it.
He does.
Jose's work.
The cancer was thyroid cancer,
yes.
And you had what? It was detected about 4 months into your pregnancy.
Yes. Uh-huh.
And you had it removed after pregnancy, and now you're, what, medication, I suppose, for the rest of your life. How do you feel?
Great.
Yeah?
Great. Yeah,
yeah.
It helps.
Boy, it doesn't look thin,
it doesn't look dry.
It looks wonderful.
No, it was. I mean, I had to do a major conditioner treatment, and we had to layer hair. It was all one length. So what we decided to do is get rid of all the dryness. And it does look better, so there is a way, there is hope for everybody out there
yeah.
who doesn't feel good, or who had a major disease. I mean, cut it, style it, and you can always look better.
What do you think, Nancy?
I think it's fine.